A House panel has resumed its probe into the budget utilization of the office of the vice president. Our very own Vivian Guglia now joins us with an update. Viv, over to you.
Like Hermina, the House Committee on Good Government and Public Accountability has ordered the issuance of subpoena and lookout bulletin against six officers under the office of the vice president who repeatedly failed to attend its hearing into the alleged irregularities in the OVP's utilization of confidential funds. These include Vice President Sara Duterte's Chief of Staff, Attorney Zulaika Lopez, OVP's Assistant Chief of Staff and Chairperson of the Bids and Awards, Attorney Lemuel Ortonio, and OVP Director for Administrative and Financial Services, Attorney Rosaline Sanchez, also among the OVP's officers who will be subject of subpoena and lookout bulletin are Special Disbursing Officer Gina Acosta, Chief Accountant Julieta Villa del Rey, and Edward Fajarda. In a position paper submitted before the House panel, they said the hearing is unnecessary and that their attendance is, quote, not needed, noting that government offices like the OVP are regularly audited by the Commission on Audit. The OVP officials and personnel said that the data required by lawmakers could be verified through COA reports. They also claimed that the subject matter of the House committee deliberation is not in aid of legislation and questioned the jurisdiction of the panel to conduct the inquiry. They further said that they are, quote, extremely cautious of discussing before the committee issues already pending before the Supreme Court, citing the sub judice rules. These are consistent with Vice President Duterte's position for attending only the panel's hearing and skipping the rest. Committee Chairperson Representative Joel Chua asserted that the noncompliance and just unjustified baseless refusal to attend congressional inquiries is tantamount to a violation of the Constitution. He said the Congress has authority to inquire into the operations of the executive branch, adding that the exercise of sovereign legislative authority cannot be subordinate to a criminal or administrative investigation. In today's hearing, Congressman questioned the 16 million pesos in confidential funds and by the OVP for payment of safe houses within 11 days in December 2022, which they tagged as excessive. Gloria Camora, the team leader of the COA unit that audited the OVP's confidential expenses, agreed that the amount may be high, but that it was liquidated. Of the 125 million peso confidential funds of the OVP in 2022, 73 million pesos was disallowed by COA. Carmina, back to you.
Thanks a lot, Vivian Guglia, there joining us on the line. The Philippine poll body, along with poll watchdogs, inspected Dito Telecommunities capacity to transmit results for next year's midterm elections. Willard Cheng on the line now with that story. Willard, what more can you tell us?
Hi, Casey. Commission on Elections Chairman George Garcia visited the office of Dito Telecommunity in Taguig for a briefing on the telco's capacity to transmit results on election day. Dito is just one of the telcos tapped by the joint venture of iOne Resources and Ardent Networks for the secure electronic transmission services that would be used in the May 2025 midterm elections. Dito CEO Eric Alberto vouched for the telco's network quality, nationwide coverage, reliability, and security of its network, having passed the fifth-year audit of the National Telecommunications Commission. He also ensured the security of its cloud system and protection against cyber attacks. Dito and Comelec also allayed concerns about the use of Chinese facility, as do other telcos, pointing out that Dito uses security solutions from other countries. Meantime, Garcia wants telcos to provide the poll body with real-time data of the transmission of results, adding telcos will also have to surrender all end products of the transmission. He added that Comelec will release all transmission logs and IP addresses after the elections to ensure transparency and allow stakeholders to counter-check data. Garcia is expected to visit the offices of other telcos as well. Back to you, Casey.
Thanks a lot. Willard Cheng there joining us on the... Non-communicable diseases have been on the rise in the Western Pacific region based on a study by the World Health Organization. Ara Perez joins us now to tell us more about this. Ara, over to you.
Hermina, non-communicable disease like heart disease, stroke, diabetes, and cancer now account for nearly 9 in 10 deaths in the Western Pacific region based on a study of the WHO Western Pacific. According to Dr. Kidong Park, Director of Data, Strategy and Innovation, this is a significant shift from the time when infectious diseases and injuries were previously major causes of illness and death. Park cites the success of communicable diseases prevention and immunization programs as a reason for the shift. Major risk factors like alcohol and tobacco use and environmental factors also affected this. For Dr. Susan Mercado, Director of Program Management, lifestyle and lack of physical activity have a lot to do with the increase in non-communicable diseases, along with the intake of not just processed but ultra-processed food. Another finding in the report is that countries in the WHO Western Pacific region, including the Philippines, experienced the smallest decline in life expectancy during the COVID-19 pandemic compared to other WHO regions. Life expectancy in the region fell by 0.07 years during 2020 to 2021, which is lower compared to the global average decline of 1.7 years. Carmina.
Thanks a lot. Arab Pettis there joining us on the line.